Good morning to everybody. Today we are starting with the lecture number 8. And in lecture number 8, as you can see here, we are taking into consideration the topics related to the observation systems. That means that in our initial schema, we have finished all the physical topics related to the energy that is involved in the process, and especially the energy as it is emitted by our artificial source, natural source of energy, that is the sun, and then how this energy is interacting with the atmospheric layers and with the physical surface on the Earth. Now we are taking into consideration that this energy has been reflected or emitted toward the sensors that are mounted on board of the satellite platforms, and now we need to take into consideration the characteristics of this sensor, but especially some concept related to the optic geometry and some consideration concerning how we can evaluate the characteristics of the acquired data. So let's start with a very short introduction, and the quality of the data acquired in remote sensing depend on certain characteristics and precise specifications of the instruments used. This topic is extremely important both because the judgment and the analysis of imagery products remain an important and still irreplaceable phase in the visual interpretative process, and because the quantitative analysis on the quality of the results is a prerequisite for the certification of the products themselves. So, we need to understand the characteristics of the data because we are extracting information, and we need extracting the information in some way to certify the quality of the information extracted. The remote sensing data, whether they are numbers or images, are representations of real scenes and therefore are the results of a transfer process that takes place on the basis of the technical specification of the instrumental apparatus used in the two phases of acquisition and representations. These characteristics are linked to the general resolution concepts that control in which way the detected scene is transferred to an image. Among the observational system, a particular place is occupied by the human vision, of course, on whose functional characteristics optical instruments are designed, as well as in order to better understand the functioning of the system described in the following chapters, some introductory knowledge of the measurements of color are fundamental as a physical entity of the visible reality that surrounds us. So, we need to take into consideration how to characterize the data, and being the human vision that we approached in the previous lecture, one of the most valuable methods to observe, and this functioning of our eyes is also the primary way in which the artificial sensor are functioning, are working. So, we need also to understand, for example, how then these data can be transferred in colors or in something that is detectable with our eyes. So now we need to start with a very basic consideration that are taking into account the optic geometry. And for most of the instruments that we are using in remote sensing, one of the essential aspects is the one that is related to the optical part, whose role is to convey the radiant energy on the sensor. So, when we are acquiring data, also with our, for example, digital camera, we need an optical system that is able to convey the energy reflected or emitted from the target to the plane of our sensor. Although optical systems are usually very complex and sophisticated, composed of multiple elements, coping with refraction and reflection, and particular materials in relation to the spectral regions in which they operate, it is useful to recall some fundamental elements of geometric optics according to one simplified scheme based on the presence of a thin and biconvex reflective lens, as shown in the following figure. So this following figure is very important because you see what look at the mouse. We are now imagining this object, this target, and this is the height of this target. And this target, as in human eyes, is represented on the plane of the image here, you see, in upside down, of course, because the energy is reprojected on the plane of the image by means of this lens of the optical system you see here. And in this figure here, what is very important are different things. At the beginning, what we are very interested in is these two dimension, S and S1. And usually, when we are acquiring images, I mean, these two distances are in some way different, because I mean the distance between the lens and the focal plane of the image, I mean what we have in our sensors, so that is the distance S1, usually is smaller than S, that is the distance between our sensor and the object that we are imaging. And of course, in remote sensing, you will see which are the ratio between these two dimensions. Then you see here, we have two very important things here, that are the F and the F1, and the distance F, you see here, that is the same, this F here, is called focal length. So this is the distance from the optical center of the lens onto the direction of the energy, the optical direction of the energy that is connecting the point of the target to the image plane. All right, and then what is very important here is also this distance D, that is this dimension here, that is in some way connected also with this dimension here that is not reported, because these lenses here, as we talked about in a very geometric way, I mean this distance here is in some way complementary to this one, so this depth of the lens is complementary to the height of this lens, the aperture of the lens, because I mean when we are talking about a very thin lens, that means that when we have this distance is correlated to the apertures of this lens. So that means that if D is large, the lens will be very large too here, in this dimension here. So it means that when we have a very thin lens where D is very small, that means that this lens will have a very short aperture, I mean a very short distance in this dimension. All right, so we need to take into consideration these different things. So the main parameter that defines the characteristics of an objective with respect to its ability to capture light energy is the relation FD. So going back here, what is very important is to establish the ratio between this focal length and this dimension here, that as I mentioned before is related also to the aperture of the lens, so the dimension, the width of the lens. All right, So I mean this ratio between F and D, it's also called guide number F. The greater the value of this ratio, the lower the capacity of the goal of gathering light energy. So I mean when this ratio is larger, there will be less capacity of the optical system to gather energy that is coming from the target. As an example, the following table shows some comparative situations. So you see, this is based on a very simple digital camera. So for example, when you are buying a digital camera that usually has an objective with a focal length of, let's say, if it's a fixed object is 35 millimeters, and the aperture of the lens, I mean the dimension, the physical dimension of the objective is you see 17.5 millimeters, for example. You see that the guide number, of course, is 2. And when we have this lower value of D, a 7, the guide number, of course, is enlarging because, I mean, we have a more capacity. So, I mean, this guide number, that is the ratio between the focal length and the D value, if you have a very a small guide number here, you see the aperture is 45 for a focal length of 90 centimeters, so that means that is a sort of zoom. And the aperture is quite wide, so that means that there are much energy that is going into the objectives. I mean, the guide number, you see, is very low. So that means that when you have a low value, that means that these objective, these optics, are able to acquire more energy. So, because they have a larger aperture in comparison with the focal length, so that means that if we are talking about digital camera, they are more luminous. So they are able to acquire more energy, and so that means that we have more energy that is going towards our detectors, and so that means that of course we will have brighter images. Why, when this guide number is larger, that means that less energy that is going to the sensor. So that means that if you have a large guide number, that means that you will have more limitation in acquiring subject in different illumination conditions. So that means that when you have when you are in a very dark situation, in a very dark scenes, I mean, it's better to use a system with a lower number of guide lower guide number because they are more luminous, so they are able to acquire the much energy possible, also if coming from a very dark scene, in order to impress the detector. All right. In remote sensing, the value of the distance S, you remember, or of the height H0, is always very large compared to the other dimension in play. So that F is almost equal to S1, whereby the acquisition plane, where is formed the image, coincides with the focal length of the lens. In other words, with the sensor's detectors are shown in the following figures. You see, it's in Italian, but the object is the target, and of course, immagine is the image. You see that we have this lens that is focalizing in the center of the lens, the images that we are acquiring with this angle of aperture beta. Of course, I mean the distance from the central focus of the lens and the image plane is more or less similar to the focal length in comparison with the other figures. And that's why, this distance here, D0, is much greater in comparison with the eye. So I mean, while here we have some meters of focal length, and we will see that before, so here we are talking about centimeters, hundreds of centimeters. Here we are talking about hundreds of kilometers, because this is the height of the sensor mounted on board of the satellites from the Earth's surface. So I mean, these two dimensions are very dissimilar, and so that means that the focal length of the system is very similar in our case to the distance between the center of the lens and the focal plane, and that make it easy to calculate to have some calculation that we are going to have later on. All right, in this case of simplified scheme, two fundamental elements are determinant. On the one hand, the angle of view defined by the plane angle beta, which includes the instrumental view of the detected image, and on the other, the field of recovery defined by the dimension C on the detected image. These two factors are linked by these geometric relationships that you know from the basics of mathematics, that beta is equal to 2 times the arc tangent of this ratio, C divided 2 times F, and this measured in degree, and stating that for optical electronic instruments, the values of beta are typically less than 1 degree, so that means that due to the facts that the sensor is very far from the surface that is where is acquiring radiance, so this angle beta is very small, the assumption of equality between the trigonometric function and the related argument here holds that previous relation is simplified by the following. So we can simplify that simply taking into consideration that, I mean, of course these two can be simplified, but we can state the assumption of equality between the trigonometric function and the arguments. So that means that the angle beta is simply equal to the ratio between C and F. So I mean, it's very simple that the angle is equal to the dimension of the detected image, the transversal dimension of the detected image, and the focal length measured in radians. All right, where is evident that the angle of view beta is directly correlated to the size of the field of view C through the focal length F, of course. Which are the relationship between view angle and acquisition angle? So when we are, taking into consideration these figures here, where we have this area that is observed by a detector C, this area here, delta A, is on the ground, in remote sensing system, the functional and operational distinction between angle of view and angle of acquisition is very important. And you see here, we have the angle of view and the angle of acquisition. Angle of view, what we can see from one point on the ground, and angle of acquisition, what we can acquire from one point to the detector C. So in particular, it should be noted that both solid angles actually subtend two different areas. On the one hand, the area observed on the ground, that is delta A, this one, the grayish one. or rather its projection with respect to the view axis, that is delta A cosine beta. You see here we have the angle the angle beta, and so I mean in order what we are seeing, that we are seeing of course this surface here that is proportional to the cosine of this angle. And on the other the area of the detector C, this is the area of the detector that is used in the acquisition system, as in this diagram, you see. So when if the operating condition allow it, and that is when the value of the observation distance R is much greater than the dimension of the sensor and of the observed element, that is always valid, as you can imagine, for a remote sensing system where the platform is very far from the Earth's surface, the area seen on the ground is linked to the distance R and to the plane view angle beta by means of this relation, of course, that delta A times cosine theta is equal to what? To the square ray R multiplied times delta omega 1, that is equal to these things here. So, increasing the acquisition distance R, this area increase exponentially, you see here. At the same time, as the instruments move farther and farther away, the projection of the same area initially observed will occupy an area of the sensor C that is always smaller according to the relation where d omega, this angle, is equal to the ratio between C and R2. So, as a consequence, the solid angle of acquisition d omega is reduced. By equating these two terms in relation to R2, we obtain what? We obtain these things here. We obtain the facts that all these things is equal to the ratio between C and delta omega, from where we can simply say that these things here, the delta A cosine theta delta omega, is equal to these two things here, B2 and C, the beta 2 and C, right? So, I mean, where it is observed that given a certain optical system, the product between the area detected on the ground and the solid acquisition angle, d omega, remains constant, regardless of distance, and this value is equivalent to the product between the two instrumental characteristics of the system. The solid angle of view beta, that is this one, and the area of the detector C. So out from here we get two very important things, that we have a sort of independence of the radiance that the sensors is able to detect in comparison with the distance of the system. So I mean, if the surface on the ground is reflecting energy, this energy of course is attenuated by the atmosphere, but I mean we can acquire this energy regardless of the distance. But what is very important is that the value, regardless of the distance, I mean the radiance that is coming to the sensor, it depends essentially from only two different characteristics: the solid angle of view, so I mean what is able the sensor to acquire if projected on the ground, and the area of the detector C. So I mean what we are able to catch with our sensor is depending only on these two different factors. So we now want to evaluate the radiant flux phi collected by a generic sensor placed in any position of space, because I mean this is very important for us, because if we can evaluate this quantity of energy, we can fully understand all the acquisition process. From the definition of radiance L in finite terms, we have what? We have that this flux is equal to these quantities here, and substituting according to geometrical relations defined above in the previous slides, is obtained what? That this flux is equal to the radiant cell, and then to the what we mentioned before, you remember that is the beta, the angle of view, all right? So here, and the dimension of the detector. So I mean the flux will be equal to the two different elements that we had before times the L quantity, that is the radiance that is coming from the ground. From the new expression, we deduce that the radiant flux phi recorded by a detector is independent again of the observation distance from the angle theta of inclination of the surface with respect to the optical axis, while it is directly proportional to the value of the radiant cell, and also in this case to the product of the two instrumental characteristics of the system, the solid angle of view beta and the surface of the detector C. So this relation is very, very important for us, because we have many things to say that is summarized in this paragraph here. Again, you see, this radiant flux, when recorded by a sensor that is mounted on board of a satellite platform, is, you see here in bold, is independent of the observation distance, and is also independent from the angle theta of inclination of the surface with respect to the optical axis. What does it mean that? That you remember when we introduced the topics of the relations between the electromagnetic energy and the Earth's surface, we mentioned the facts that at least in the visible and in the infrared, all the surfaces on the ground are Lambertian surfaces. So that means that are rough, and they are diffuse reflectors. So that means that are independent from the angle of incidence of the electromagnetic energy as is coming from the sun, but is also, and this is very clear from here, independent from the position in which the detector is placed in space. And so I mean reflecting and be opaque in all the upper hemisphere whenever the sensor is placed on the ground, and wherever is the sun height, I mean this surface, if the reflectance coefficient rho is more than zero, will reflect, and this reflection will be cached, will be caught by the sensor mounted on board the satellites. And then this energy is directly proportional to the radiance. And of course, depends on these two factors, the solid angle as before, and the detectors. But the facts that is directly proportional, this energy that is recorded by the sender, by the detector C, is directly proportional to the radiance that is coming from the ground, is very important for us, because when we have our images in correspondence to every single cell of the image, we have a digital number. So a number that, taking into consideration this equation, is proportional to the radiance that is coming from the ground. So that means that this digital number, that will of course we will transform in a real value of radiance is directly proportional to the radiance that is coming from the ground. So when we are reading this digital number, of course we are taking into consideration that this digital number are proportionally related to the radiance that is coming from the surface that is included in every single cell of the image matrix. Alright, so now having finished and I just going to control if we are still recording, yes, and we have half an hour of registration. Now we are taking into consideration all the characteristics that give us the possibility to characterize the data that we are acquiring, that definitely are data that are transferred in form of images. So let's start with the scale factor. In the acquisition phase, an extremely important feature of the system is the scale ratio, defined as the ratio between the distance of two points on the acquired image and the real distance corresponding to the ground. For example, when we are considering, for example, maps, a scale of 1 to 55,000, I mean a zero is missing here, means that the unit of representation of the topographic maps corresponds to 25,000 units on the ground. So that means that if I'm measuring 1 centimeter on the map, that corresponds to 25,000 centimeters on the ground. The scale factor, therefore, indicates the reduction ratio with which a real scene is acquired by a sensor. It is defined as this simple ratio. So the scale factor is equal to the ratio between the focal length, that in case of remote sensing is the distance between the nodal center of the lens and the image plan, and this h, that is, I mean, the distance between the sensor and the surface that we are imaging, that is placed on the ground. So here is the representation. F is the focal length of the detection system, and h is the distance or height between the sensor and the scene. So in geomatics, commonly the scale values are subdivided according to three intervals: small, medium, and large scale. Pay attention, because often in current use the terms small and large scale are used contrary to their numerical meaning, in favor of the concept of aerial extension that this adjective implies. So that means that for us, large scale in geomatics and of course in remote sensing too, large scale is depending on a very small scale factor. That means that this quantity here is larger than in a small scale. So when we have a small scale, for example in remote sensing, a small scale is something that is for example 1 to 100,000 scale, while for us large scale is for example 1 to 5,000, for example. In mapping, a large scale is 1 to 1,000, while a smaller scale is, for example, 1 to 25,000. So I mean, pay attention to how you are using this concept in geomatics. So here, for example, you see, this is the very first time that we are taking into consideration this kind of table, where you see we are comparing different sensors, and these are the name of the sensor that has mounted all on satellite platform. You see, for example, here Polder, MOVIS, AVHRR, ALI, Aster, ATM Plus that we already know, HRV Spots, Iconos, QuickBird, WorldView, GeoHigh. And you see in this first column here, for example, here we have something that is really related to the scale factor. So that means a console resolution. That means that every single cell of the image is around 1,000 meters, so 1 kilometer. So that means that this scale, the scale of this image, because of course, as maps, also the image have a certain scale factor. This scale here is a very small scale, while going here down to this column, here, very high resolution, that means that we have less than, for example, here, 1 meter on the ground. You see here we have 0.82, till here, that is 0.5, half a meter on the ground. That means that these are images acquired by these sensors here, IKONOS, GOI, and so on, that are characterized by a very high scale ratio. That means that are large scale images. Then you see here in the other column, so we have spectral bands, spatial resolution, radiometric resolution, temporal resolution, and these four concepts here that are ranging from spectral resolution, spatial resolution, or geometric resolution, radiometric resolution, and temporal resolution will be the topics of the next slides. Because now we are beginning to talk about resolution. So, among the most important features of the observation systems are the different resolution specifications linked to the ability to describe the scene detected in terms of geometric or spatial detail, spectral content, detector radiometric sensitivity, and finally temporal frequency or revisiting time. So, let's start with the geometric resolution. And of course, this concept, the general concept of resolution in the four different acceptions, is necessary for us in order to fully understand the characteristics of the different data acquired by the different sensors that are orbiting on board of the different satellite platforms that are now available. So we are starting with geometrical resolution, and out of these four different resolutions, that I remind you is geometric, spectral, radiometric, and temporal. Geometric resolution is one of the most important and is the most difficult to explain because you need to take care of different aspects of the geometric resolution, as we are beginning to see. So, the concept of geometric resolution is relative to the dimension of the objects that can be detected in a scene and expresses the detail reachable by the acquisition system. More specifically, it expresses the minimum distance necessary to keep two contiguous objects of given dimensions distinct. So I don't recap that, but I want just to introduce the fact that we are in a remote sensing course. So our data usually are images. So all whatever we are saying related to the different concept of resolution is related to images acquired by sensors, usually on board of aerial platform, both for example orbiting in the space, or placed on board of airplane or drones, for example. So pay attention that we are talking about images. All right, related to the concept of geometric resolution are those of recognizability and representability of objects for which complementary boundary conditions, such as contrast, which are essential in defining the detectable and representable detail. In fact, with the same resolving capacity of a system, the separability between different objects, in addition to their dimensions, is linked to their radiometric contrast. As an example, think of what happens in the astronomical fields in the observation of two stars that appears as two luminous points in a black space and that are distinguished until their relative distance makes them separate to the observer. When they are too far away from the point of observation, their relative distance is reduced and their images approach and merge until at a certain point they lose their individuality. Likewise, the contrast is that characteristics which make it possible to distinguish objects such as a river or a road even when their dimensions are lower than those theoretically detectable by the system. So I mean, this is, I mean, the ability of a system and also of our eyes to consider two objects very close to each other as separate, now you have the feeling that is also linked with contrast. I mean, if I can see something that is very different from the neighborhood, the neighborhood objects, I mean, I can catch it from an image or from our eye. But I mean, this is related to the contrast, and this relation with the contrast, I try to establish and to explain you this relation in the following slides. So, in order then to try to define the geometrical resolution, we need to start with the contrast. So, for in remote sensing, the concept of contrast is fundamental because it determines the primary condition of recognizability of object in a scene. It is defined as the ratio between the image brightest part and the darkest one, or rather between the values of maximum and minimum irradiance. These two quantity here that we can call E max and E mean, registered by a detector. So I mean the irradiance, I remind you, is the energy that is residing in our case over our detectors of the sensor. And so if we are registering the maximum and the minimum irradiance, we can evaluate this contrast value that is generally defined by one of the following parameters that is called CR, that stands for contrast ratio, and CM, that is the contrast module. And this simply calculated in this way. This contrast ratio is the ratio between the maximum and minimum irradiance, while this is the module of contrast, the contrast module, that is simply the ratio and is normalized the ratio of the same quantity, the maximum and minimum irradiance. And you see here is normalized by these terms. So I mean the contrast module, you see, is ranging from zero when the maximum and minimum irradiance is the same, so that means that there's no contrast because all the image is characterized by the same irradiance, by the same value, or could be, I mean, very large, infinite, because there's a very short, very large range of irradiance. So, an example that better clarifies the concept of contrast in physical terms is the effect of the presence of the atmospheric haze during an aerial acquisition. By its definition, the contrast in a scene, and therefore in its representation in the image in our case, is linked to the two extreme values of the intensity of the irradiance that we mentioned before, so E max and E mean, coming from the scene and affecting the sensor. In turn, these quantities depend on the reflectivity characteristics of the observed scene and on the atmospheric transparency T, that is regulated, of course, by the atmospheric windows. And this atmospheric transparency T is something that is very related to the transmission coefficient tau at the time of the acquisition. Furthermore, it is necessary to consider the component due to the contribution of the radiance LATM, that is the radiance that is coming from the atmosphere itself and known as path radiance width, not depending on the characteristic of the acquired area, causes any undifferentiated increase in radius of the sensor. So this is quite important because you see, when we have a sensor that is mounted on board of a satellite, and I already told you these things here, when we are acquiring radiance on the detector plane of the sensor, we are acquiring radiance that is coming from the ground. By means of reflection or emission from the ground, but we are also catching on the detector the quantity of energy that is coming from, for example, for scattering interaction. So, for example, in normal condition, we are registering the Rayleigh scattering that is, of course, affecting, for example, in most part, the visible bands of the acquired images. And so this energy is not coming from the ground, from what we are interested in, because I remind you, we are taking into consideration EO system, so Earth observation system. We are particularly interested in analyzing what is happening on the ground and not what is happening in the atmosphere. We are not climatologists. We are not analyzing meteorological forecast. So I mean, what is coming from the atmosphere for scattering is annoying us, and we need to model this quantity in order to reduce the radiance that is registered from the sensor. So, considering the atmosphere, an isotropic medium, and remembering that for an isotropic medium the irradiance is equal to P greg to for the times radiance, the following relation will be valid, and this is the relation. So the maximum irradiance and the minimum irradiance will be depending on the rho coefficient, of course, on how much the surface on the ground is reflecting energy, because here we are not considering the emission, and this energy will be multiplied from the tau, that is the transmission coefficient of the atmosphere, that is related, as I mentioned before, to the atmospheric windows. And this first terms here is related to the quantity of energy in which we are interested. So this is what is coming from the ground, that is, of course, proportional to these two coefficients. The reflectance coefficient of the surface that is comprised in our cell of the image, and the tau coefficient, that is the transparency of the atmosphere in these particular spectral bands. But we have also this quantity here, that is the energy that is reflected in the upper hemisphere, so towards the sensor, by means of the atmosphere in these phenomena that we already took into account, that is called scattering, both selective or non-selective scattering or mild scattering. So this is for the Emax and for the Emin. So from which it is obtained that the contrast modulation value of the CM image, as we mentioned before, expressed as a function of the physical radiometric parameter, is this one. So, if we are now characterizing this contrast module using the real case of the energy that is coming from the ground, from the surface on the ground, and from the atmosphere, we have this module of contrast. And in this module of contrast, from this relationship, it is evident that the contribution of the radiance that is coming from the atmosphere by scattering, being placed in the denominator, you see here, it's here, induce a lowering of the resulting contrast value. So you see here that if the module of contrast is higher, then the image will be more contrasted. If it's lower, the image is very less contrasted. So, for example, in the case where the reflectance coming from the ground is the same, so the minimum and the maximum is the same, that means that we get an image with the same digital number for all the cell. So that means that the module of contrast is equal to zero. There's no contrast at all. But taking into consideration that the diffusion stay in the denominator, that means that the scattering, for example, is annoying us because induce a lowering in the resulting contrast value. All this confirms the direct experience according to which the increase of the optical thickness negatively affects the quality of the resulting images, definitely lowering the contrast. And for example, when we are we mentioned the fact that this is the case of when we have haze or fog, that means that you see all these grayish tones related to the what we see with our eyes, for example in the fog, that means that staying at the denominator here, because it's something that is happening with the interrelation between the electromagnetic energy and the atmosphere, so it's a scattering problem. In that case, it's a non-selective scattering. That means that these grayish tones, of course, based on our experience, is lowering the contrast of what we are seeing. So we see all in a grayish tones without the ability to check and to see differences in two different targets that we are observing, like in a very clear day. So I mean, this scattering is lowering the contrast. And these effects, obviously, and this is as usual in remote sensing, is ranging with the wavelength lambda considered in relation to the different intensity of the interaction mechanisms seen between the electromagnetic energy and the atmosphere. So you all know that, for example, for the Rayleighs, for the selective scattering, this scattering is called selective because it's ranging in the different wavelengths. So, of course, also the evaluation of the contrast is depending on the wavelengths. So let's check where we are with the registration. So we have 50 minutes. So let's continue with the presentation, with the lecture. So right, so we saw all these things here, and now after the contrast, now we are able to measure the contrast, and we will perform this operation during the labs, during the next labs. Now we have another things to take into account that is called the resolving power. We are still in the geometric resolution case. So what is the resolving power? The resolving power of a system is defined as the ability to identify a certain number of rows or bars of a certain size per unit of space in situation of maximum contrast and therefore black and white. You see here, this is a very nice image that is here. You see, look at my mouse. This target here, that is a very typical target, is called resolving power test target.
The resolving power, therefore, does not directly express the dimension of the smallest object identifiable on the scene, but the value of spatial frequency, PV, considered as the number of pairs of objects called cycles, clearly identifiable in a certain observation at a certain observation distance. It is established by comparing already prepared models usually used in the photographic and photogrammetric fields, like this target here. So which is the importance of this target? You see that we have these different numbers, this large number -1, -2, and here -2, and then we have 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 for every single class of targets. You see, these are bars at the maximum possible contrast. You see, we have white bars on a black background. So that means that these bars, white bars, are in the better contrast situation. So this is the better contrast that our eyes could catch, and also, of course, artificial sensor. And which are the characteristics of these bars? That you see, they are coupled, I mean they are horizontal and vertical. That means that these bars, dimension of these bars, the length and the width of these bars, in particular the width, is the same of the distance between two different bars. So this white part here, look at the mouse, is the same of this black part here. And when you have increasing number, you see the width of the bar is diminishing. Okay, also in terms of width of the bar, and you see they are smaller and even smaller. And so one of the tests you can also do by yourself is just to place at a certain distance to this resolving power test target, and by observing that in a perpendicular position, for example, stay to 1 meter from your screen, the resolving power of our eyes is related to the target that you can see as separate lines. For example, now I'm just doing this when performing these lectures here, I'm just seeing that I have the maximum resolving power staying to very few centimeters from the screen. I can get separate the lines in this here, in this position here. You see, in the position in the number one, group one, and this is the group six. While here I cannot see the lines separate. So that means that, of course, this is a way to understand not only this particular characteristic, that is till which distance you can see this line as separate. Because if then they are fused, that means that our eyes or the system that we are using is not able to consider as separate these two lines in the two different configuration, horizontal and vertical. All right, the resolving power of a system or part of it is measured with respect to the standard reference models of black and white bars in terms of spatial frequency, PV, measured in lines for millimeters or cycle for millimeters, of course, on the images. The inverse value of this number expresses the size of the line or bar resolved to the target. In fact, we have this quantity here. So this is the inverse, where PL expresses the resolving power to the target in linear terms, and corresponds, in fact, to the geometric resolution considered as the size of the smallest element distinguishable in the scene taken. So I mean, this is a very important parameter that is affecting the geometric resolution, because with the resolving power in this way we can have a measurements of the smallest elements we can get in an image in the acquired scene. So, for example, you see, and this is related to the separability problem, as we mentioned at the beginning, the stars, when you are observing that with the telescope, you see here, there's a single element, and this is the representation of how are changing, for example, the digital number. You see that in the center the value is very bright in the Y scale, while just far from the center the digital number is going to be darker, so black. So you see here, and you see here, this is in the figure C, the maximum separability. So you see here that we see two different points that are characterized by this distribution of the digital number, and you already know that because you saw that during the labs. While in these central figures, in the case B, you see, I mean, these two things, these two points are very, or these two stars, like the example at the beginning of these resolution concept topics, they are too close in order to be considered separate. So, I mean, of course, here, the geometric resolution is larger than this one, because, I mean, we cannot see the difference between two different points. Well, you see here, in the figure C, we see that, while in the figure A, we have the two points that are fused in only one. All right, so, what we need also? We need also to evaluate, for the geometric resolution, the field of view. Depending on the instruments used, the beta angle or field of an optical system can take on different meanings. In the case, it refers to the overall angle of view of a system, for example, the whole view angle, acquiring the whole strip of a scanning device that is called SWOT, and we go through that SWOT later on. The field FOV, or FOV, that is an acronym that stands for field of view. When the angle of view refers to the smallest angle solvable by a system, for example, that subtended by a detector in optical electronic instruments, the relative field takes the name of EFOV, that stands for instantaneous field of view, at least described in this figure. So you see here, this is the case of an airplane that has mounted on board a sensor, that is the V direction is the flight direction. So you see is acquiring, for example, the image, a strip of an image strip in this direction V. So the FOV, the field of view, is what the sensor is embracing. If projected on the surface, and this is called the SWOT width, while the instantaneous field of view is the single acquisition that will be represented in the acquired image with one single cell of the image. So we can easily transfer the FOV like the transversal dimension of the image, and the EFOV like the dimension of a single cell. Right? And so if we are considering, let me take the possibility to go back, if we are considering the resolving power, of course the instantaneous field of view is something that is affecting the resolving power. Because of course, like in this case, if we are taking two different objects on our image plane, and these objects are in two contiguous cells, all right, the results will not be the C figure, but it will be the B and then the A figures. So that means that if we have two different objects in two contiguous cells and they are reflecting the same quantity of energy, so they have the same brightness, of course, we cannot see as two different things, of course, because they are laying in two contiguous cells depending on the instantaneous field of view. So, therefore, the values of the EFOV is another way of expressing the geometric resolution of an observation system. In fact, remember the simplification due to the very small angles of beta, we obtain, respectively, these things here, that the EFOV is equal to the ratio between PL and S, and we can represent that in a linear configuration. So what is the dimension of the instantaneous field of view if reprojected on the ground in one dimension, because we assume that the cells of the image are perfectly squared, so I mean the two dimensions are the same, so I can represent that only in one dimension, or we can I can consider also the EFOV measured in angles in this way here, so that things will be measured in meters and this quantity in radians. Of course, it's much better for us to measure the geometric resolution and the field of view and the EFOV in particular in meter, because it's simpler. So then EFOV L express is expressed in linear and E alpha in angular terms, respectively. When considering the two dimension in the ground projection plane of the instant field of view, an area that is called the GFOV, that is the ground instantaneous field of view, is determined, which expresses the geometrical resolution parameters of a system in aerial terms. So in order to characterize our sensors from the geometrical point of view, we will use the ground EFOV. Because, I mean, the EFOV, as expressed here, you will see, is not constant over the different columns of the image. So we need to regularize the different EFOV in what we are calling GFOV, the ground EFOV. But we will see that before, later on. The geometric resolution can also be characterized by this quantity that is called MTF. When the assessment of the performance of the optical system is considered necessary, a commonly used measure is the modulation transfer function that is called, that is the acronym is MTF. The MTF is used for optical components as simple as a spherical singlet lens to those as complex as a multi-element telecentric imaging lens assembly. In order to understand the significance of MTF, consider some general principle and practical example for defining MTF, including its component, importance, and characterization. Having defined previously the two terms required to truly characterize image performance, resolution and contrast, it's now necessary to transfer this concept to digital images, of course. With regards to geometric resolution, a practical way of understanding line pairs is to think of them as pixels on a camera sensor, where a single line pair corresponds to 2 pixels, and we will see that in the next figures. 2 camera sensor pixels are needed for each line pair of resolution. 1 pixel is dedicated to the red line and the other to the black space between pixels, of course, as I mentioned before. Using the aforementioned metaphor, image resolution of the camera can now be specified as equal to twice its pixel size. You see here, when we are acquiring the image, for example, with a digital camera, you see here we have the lens. Look at the mouse here, we have the lens with the nodal center of the lens. You see, when we are acquiring the image with 2 different square, if I'm representing that on 2 contiguous pixel of the image or cell of the image, of course, I mean, we are not able to consider these two things as separate. You see here, when this sensor, I'm sorry, these two rectangles or square on the image are in a certain distance, and this distance is enough to be represented in our image with a separation of at least one pixel or one cell, that means that I can consider these two elements as separate. So you see, if I measure this line pair here, this is the resolving power of the system. I mean, how I can consider different two elements on the image. So this is the scenario A, where the line pair is not resolved. I mean, they are not differentiated, these two different square, while here is considered resolved because I can see these two square, red square, as separate. All right, concerning contrast, consider normalizing the intensity of a bar target by assigning a maximum value to the white bars and zero value to the black bars. Plotting these values result in a square wave from which the motion of contrast can be easily seen. You see, these are the pixel of the cell of the image. I can here, as we have learned in the lab, for example, with the software Envy, we can use the radiometric section here. So here I have in the x-axis the distance, the position of the cell, and in the y-axis I have the digital number that is ranging from black, so to from zero, to white, for example, in 8-bit acquisition to 255. You see, I can represent this cell like these things here, like a square wave that is ranging in comparison with the variation of the digital number of the cell of the images. So, to understand the relation between contrast and image quality, consider an image acquired with the same resolution as the ones in the previous figures, but used to image an object with a greater line pair frequency. Figures below illustrate that as the spatial frequency of the lines increase, the contrast of the image decreases. This effect is always present when working with imaging lenses of the same resolution. For the image to appear defined, the black must be truly black and white truly white, with a minimal amount of grayscale between. So you see here, when we are acquiring, as before, these black bars, so white bars is the same, here is the negative than before, and this is the real image, and this is, you see, the radiometric section of these things with the maximum contrast here from black to white in this passage here, and this is the measure of the line pair. When I am representing that on an image, I mean, the sensor is acquiring due to the particular geometric resolution of the system, it is acquiring an analog signal that is the quantity of radiance that is coming from the target. So, I mean, it's not acquiring this kind of energy, this squared wave, but it's acquiring something that is this modulation of energy, you see here, because I mean, is acquiring a continuous quantity of radiance that is coming from the ground. This is not stopping here, but I mean, from black to white, but is changing in a smooth form, and you will understand that when we will take into consideration the sampling effects. So, in reality, on the image, due to the relation with the lenses, I mean, the image is acquiring this amount of radiance that is changing, and so you see, This is the results of this acquisition on the real image. So you don't have really black and white bars, but you have black and black bars separated by a different intensity of grayish. This is very difficult to explain from the theoretical point of view, but that means that it will be appear very more understandable when we will go in the labs and during the labs when we are facing the problem that is related with this radiometric wedge, the Kodak one, that I will deliver to you directly. And it is a radiometric wedge, that are radiometric bars, in where you will understand, fully understand this problem. That is not easy to be understood in theoretical terms without any experimental test over a real image. But don't worry, because the theoretical modulation transfer function, MTF curve, can be generated from the optical prescription of any lens. So I mean, for example, you see here, these are the same targets as before. So the MTF is the function that is relating to these characteristics here. So when you are having this frequency that is higher, so when you have more variation in the space, more frequency, that means these black bars are even close each other. So when they are closing, and so the frequency of the variation of the exposition is changing, so is more frequent, and more frequent means that the bars are close to each other, we can represent the MTF as the ability to consider in very low, in very high frequency of the variation. So in this case, when the bars are closer than in this case here, for example, in 2-2, in this case 3-5, they are closer, of course, of the 2-2. So I mean there are a higher frequency of the variation. This is the explanation of the MTF. When a system is able to take trace of this very high frequency of variation, and this measure is of course performed using these targets. And you see here, you have the two targets acquired with two different optics, with the same sensor, but two different optics. And you see that the result is very different, because in the right part, in this part here, in the right figures, you see we have a very nice contrast, and you can see the difference between the different bars, both in horizontal and vertical asset. While in the left figure, you see that in these two boxes, the red and the blue, you see that there's a blurred effect. I mean, is the contrast is reduced, and you see here it's quite difficult to see the difference between the bars, the white bars. And you see these are other examples of other acquisition. You see again in the left figures there's a blurred image, so a lower MTF function. So that means that you see here is very clear that in the left part, in the left image, the contrast is lower than the right image. Right, here are other two examples. You see, in the blue part, left side, the image is very blurred. I mean, seems to be is very low contrasted, while here is very high contrasted. But you see that being very high contrasted, look at the numbers, you have these effects here that is not continuous, for example the number 6, but you see these effects that in technical terms is called pixelation. You see the single pixels that are composing the images, and this is due to the effects of a high MTF. All right, so concerning the geometric resolution and going to the conclusion, In conclusion, the geometric resolution, which depends primarily on the contrast between the elements of the scene, can be measured through various parameters, including the resolving power of the different definition PL, PI, P alpha, the instantaneous if of field of view, and the PSF, point spread function, or when you want a description of the operating efficiency of the system in the transfer of spatial information from the real scene to the represented one, the MTF, the modulation transfer function, and the value of the AFOV, that is the effective EFOV, or as we will see in the next lecture, the GFOV, the ground instantaneous field of view. So, in conclusion, so we will measure these things here, the geometric resolution. Let me go back to the initial table here. So when we are going to this initial table, you see here spatial resolution, that is the geometric resolution, is measured in meters. So for example, here you see that the sensor polder has a resolution for every single cell of 6,000 meters, so 6 kilometers, going to very high geometric resolution sensor that is acquiring half a meter on the ground. So the fact that every single cell has a dimension of half a meter by times half a meter. So I mean, this is the dimension in comparison with this one. So I mean, we are measuring the geometric resolution in remote sensing in corresponding meters of the cell. But you will see in the lab that the this geometric resolution is not always the only thing that we are that can characterize, of course, what you can detect on the ground. So now we are going to the spectral resolution. So I mentioned before the spectral, radiometric, and temporal resolution are easier to explain because they are very simple. So one of the main aspects of remote sensing is the possibility of multispectral analysis, as I already mentioned, by means of which the investigation is conducted simultaneously on different portions of the electromagnetic spectrum in order to improve the physical recognizability of the surfaces that are subject of the study. Therefore, one of the most important features of an observation system is certainly its spectral resolution, which commonly refers to the number of bands in which the spectral sensitivity range of the system is divided. So that means that having another definition, the spectral resolution is the ability of the sensor to acquire the reflectivity or the emissivity that is coming from the ground in different spectral bands. So the concept of spectral resolution is in turn linked to that of spectral resolving power, which determines the step of sampling wavelengths, lambda, of course, at which measurements are made with a given instrument, and expresses the ability of a system to distinguish two length waveforms based on concepts similar to those already seen in the geometric resolution. So in order to better understand the importance of spectral resolution, consider the importance of best separating the spectral characteristic of the observed surfaces, overcoming those situations where their behavior appears ambiguous or very similar and therefore difficult to identify. Let's have an example. A survey conducted with a sensor with a wide spectral sensitivity that includes the entire spectra of visible and near infrared will bring the behavior of a stagnant body of water to that of a vegetation cover closer in terms of reflectivity. In the following figure, that example is generalized and kept very simple using color. So, for example, you can fully understand that if I have many different bands, I can, of course, by simply visualizing in false color using the near infrared, I can get in red colors all the vegetation. If I'm using only one single band, the possibility to distinguish vegetation from other surfaces on the ground, you can understand very easily, is much difficult. So, I mean, in order to keep that very simply using colors, you see that I'm using only four different colors. Look at the mouse here in the first line. I mean, I can separate four different things that are reflecting in these four different colors. Of course, if I'm using more intervals, I can discriminate more different surfaces. And here, from four, I can go to 12 different possible surfaces, possible colors. So that means that when here I have only one single blue, here I have three kinds of blue. Here, out of from green, I can get green, yellow, and orange. Here, I have three different color, different tones of red, and so on. So you see, if I'm enlarging the spectral bands in where we are, I'm acquiring the signal coming from the ground, being reflected or emitted is the same. If I'm enlarging the spectral bands that I'm using, of course, diminishing the range of wavelengths that I'm using, so having more spectral bands, of course, I can facilitate the interpretation of the data, just extracting information. So the ability to separate on a spectral basis, therefore, increases with the ability of the number of bands. Not surprisingly, an extremely interesting developing sector is the hyperspectral detection that allows, taking into consideration the previous example, to extract a very high number of color classes, much closer to the continuity, or imaging spectrometry. For example, you will have at your disposal the data that are acquired by this sensor, MIBIS, that is mounted on board on an airplane, that is able to acquire 102 different spectral bands. And so, during the labs, you see how using this very high number of spectral bands, in this case an hyperspectral sensor, is modifying, for example, the possibility to extract spectral signature. The third concept of resolution is related to the radiometric resolution. I'm sorry, I'm just checking at what point we are. We are 1 hour and 26 minutes, so we will last for a longer time this lecture. We have seen how the contrast is decisive in the definition of geometric resolution, but it's also important to represent the signal in a certain number of gray levels, in particular for us, in a certain number of digital numbers. So the number of gray levels within a dynamic scale, using a representation of the scene, expresses the radiometric resolution of an image. It's a bit like what happens when the contrast is adjusted on a television set. In fact, the number of intermediate gray levels varies between the extreme values, which remain constant, that is black and white. In this way, by reducing the relative contrast between one level and another, which occurs by inserting more levels of gray, the image is actually enriched. So, for example, when we are seeing these values, you see, we can sample on board of the sensor the radiance into different digital number values. So, for example, this radiometric resolution is measured in bit, and this is the general definition, is the ability of the sensor to sample the radiance in a certain numbers of intervals. So, for example, here we have the same image acquired on the ground, and this is the image acquired with a radiometric resolution of one single byte, because this radiometric resolution is measured in byte. With one single byte, we have only two possible values, 0 and 1, that corresponds to black and white, only two single gray tones. When we are using two beats, the possible combination are only four. So here we have four different values. So the radiometric resolution is 2 bit. When we have 3 bits, we have 8 values. 4 bits, 16 values. So you see that enlarging and increasing the number of bits in which we are sampling the signal, of course, the image is even better if using more bits. So, for example, in the images that we are used till now in the labs, the radiometric resolution is 8 bits, and 8 bits allows a combination of 256 different values. Of course, if I'm enlarging 8 bits and, for example, I'm using 9 bits, the results will be 512. If I'm using, for example, 10 bits, the results will be 1024, and so on. So, larger is the number of bits that the sensor is using to sample the signal, the radiance that is coming from the ground, greater will be our ability to have more gray tones, more digital numbers available for the analysis. The last concept of resolution is the temporal resolution. So, together with the multispectral analysis, that is essentially related to the spectral resolution, one of the most significant aspects in remote sensing is certainly the concept of temporal resolution, that is linked to the possibility of repeating the observation at constant or programmable time intervals. This aspect is fundamental for the control of the dynamics of natural phenomena and is the basis of the multitemporal acquisition in the general perspective of the observation of changes, that is the change detection techniques. In this sense, the temporal resolution can range from hourly fractions for geostationary meteorological satellites to periods longer than the order of 15-35 days for polar sun-synchronous satellites. The temporal resolution plays an extremely important and sometimes is a constraint role regarding some essential aspects, such as the choice of acquisition passages with regard to the application. This thing here is decisive in some environmental application, for example, for a study of algal bloom in water bodies or of the phenological phases of a vegetative cycle, where the phenomena to be studied evolve in particular seasonal moments. So it becomes essential to make a selection, specify the available steps, and plan any in-situ calibration campaigns regarding the calendar of satellite's orbit of interest. So, a second aspect is the acquisition's availability. A major limitation on the quality and quantity of acquisitions, especially for satellite with optical sensors, is represented by the influence of the atmosphere during the acquisition phase, so that the numbers of effectively useful passages with respect to programming is ultimately greatly reduced. So, as an example, based on a time frequency of 16 days for a given size, the Landsat series satellites should guarantee more than 20 passes a year, which, for meteorological reasons, can be reduced to 4-5 with a loss effective of more than 60 of those planned. So, I mean, for example, the Landsat platform is passing every 16 days over the same spots. So that means that it can acquire more or less 20 images over the year. But due to the different latitude, due of course to the meteorological condition, for example, cloud cover, there are parts of the Earth's surface where it is very difficult to acquire images. Think about, for example, the equatorial forests, where due to the evapotranspiration, there's always a sort of haze or cloud cover that is covering the forest during the day. So indeed, in this area, we have the possibility, for example, with Landsat, to acquire 20 images a year. But if you are browsing the archive, you will see that there are years in which there are no images available. There are cloud free, because we are interested in looking what is happening on the Earth's surface, and there are no images cloud free. And in general terms, you see here that out of 20 passes, there are only few scenes that are fully cloud free. So that means that there the theoretical repetition time, but the effective repetition time, of course, it depends on the meteor condition. And there's also a topic related to the amount of data. And high temporal resolution values implies a greater possibility to study the evolution of natural phenomena, being able to follow the phenomenon with more appropriate frequency and increasing the probability of useful data. Of course, if you are increasing the acquisition, you will maximize the probability to have a cloud-free condition. Considering, for example, the possibility of having a fire large-scale maps for the entire globes every day. In this case, however, it is also necessary to take into account the large amount of data acquired and the whole consequent capacity of computing resources required to their storage and their processing and interpretation. Just to summarize in this concept here, consider that right now in Europe, the Sentinel image archive, and Sentinel is the constellation of the Copernicus constellations, all the images that are acquired daily by these different satellites constitutes the larger big data archive that is present now in Europe. So you see, it's very easy, as you can see from the data that I delivered to you, it's very easy to deal with a very huge and very massive quantity of data. So, in order to finish this lecture that is quite long, I need also, having finished, to talk about the repetition, the temporal resolution that is measured in terms of the time span that is necessary to acquire two different images on the same area. I need to introduce the concept of orbits and swaths, because they are affecting directly the temporal resolution, and there are also a very important things that you need to know. So the path followed by a satellite is referred to as its orbit. Satellite orbits are matched to the capability and objective of the sensors that they carry. Orbit selection can vary in terms of altitude, their height above the Earth's surface, and their orientation and rotation relative to the Earth. Satellites at a very high altitude, which view the same portion of the Earth's surface at all times, have what we called geostationary orbits. These geostationary satellites, at altitudes at approximately 36,000 kilometers, revolve at speed which match the rotation of the Earth. So they seem stationary, and this is the name of this orbit, geostationary, relative to the Earth's surface. This allows the satellites to observe and collect information continuously over specific areas. Weather and communication satellites commonly have this type of orbits. Due to their high altitude, some geostationary weather satellites can monitor weather and cloud patterns cover an entire hemisphere of the Earth. So this is the first possible configuration of the orbits. This is a satellite that is placed on geostationary orbits, in which the orbital period, that means that is the time span that is necessary to pass from deposition and to complete a cycle, so an entire orbit, at this height, around 36,000 kilometers, is 24 hours. So that means that the movement along the orbits of the satellite is equal to the movement of the Earth rotation. That means that the satellite is acquiring always the same hemisphere because it's observing always the same hemisphere. Usually, these geostationary orbits are these orbits are placed in the equatorial plane. So here, so is observing from the equator to the North Pole and to the South Pole, a particular hemisphere. So, for example, that fully explain the fact that, for example, meteo satellites are of course geostationary satellites, and that means that, for example, the Europe, the European Space Agency launched several versions of the Meteosat satellite, that is the meteorological European satellite, that is mounted in that particular latitude. So it's able to image the hemisphere in which Europe is. Of course, the Americans, the Russians, the Japanese, the Australians have different satellites, geostationary meteo satellites, because they are placed in different positions. Because, of course, the American satellites, that are called NOAA, are imaging only the hemisphere in which the North America is placed. And so that means that they are placed in a different latitude, corresponding latitude, in order to imagine only the States. And of course, they are not imaging Europe, of course, while the European satellites are not imaging nor the States and nor the Japan or Australia, for example. So many remote sensing platforms are designed to follow an orbit, basically north-south, which, in conjunction with the Earth's rotation west-east, allows them to cover most of the Earth's surface over a certain period of time, and this is very important. These are near-polar orbits, so named for the inclination of the orbit relative to a line running between the North and the South Poles. Many of these satellites' orbits are also called sun synchrons, such that they cover each area of the world at a constant local time of day called local sun time. So that means that at any given latitude, the position of the sun in the sky as the satellite passes overhead will be the same within the same season. This ensures consistent illumination conditions when acquired images in a specific season over successive years or over a particular area over a series of days. This is an important factor for monitoring changes between images or for mosaicing adjacent images together, as they do not have to be corrected for different illumination conditions. So you see, this is the classical example of sun-synchronous satellites, orbits that are near-polar. You see, the plane, and this is the orbit, you see here the red line, is the plane of this orbit is perpendicular to the equatorial plane and is inclined of a certain quantity with respect to the plane that is comprising North and Southern Pole. So that means that these satellites are orbiting in this way around the Earth from North to South Pole. The altitude of these orbits is much lower than the meteo satellites because it's an order that is ranges between 400 to around 1,000 kilometers, so they are very close in comparison with the geostationary platforms. That means that the orbital time, so the time that is needed to finish one single orbit, is ranging between 80 to 100 minutes. So that means that every 1 hour and a half, an orbit is completed. In this 1 hour and a half, the Earth is rotating in this way, you see, it's rotating. So that means that profiting on the rotation movement of the Earth, the satellite are able, after a certain period of time, to acquire all the Earth's surface. That is contrary to the geostationary satellites that are always imaging only one hemisphere and not the whole surface of the Earth. What is very important to assume, as mentioned before, that at the same latitude the satellite is passing to the same local time. So that means that at 45 degrees north in Turin, for example, the satellite, depending on the different sensor, of course, different satellites, are passing in the morning from 10 to 11 a.m. usually. So that means that if it's passing at the same local time, that means that in the same season or in consecutive days, the high of the sun on the horizon is always the same. So you remember that the quantity of energy that is emitted by the sun, that is inciding over the Earth's surface in a certain latitude, is depending, the quantity of energy is directly proportional to the cosine of the inciding angle, of the incident angle. So if the image is acquired with the same incident angle, that means that the quantity of energy is always the same in different days. So that means that I can perform multi-temporal analysis without the problems to changing the incident angle, that is definitely changing the quantity of energy that is inciding over the Earth's surface, and then of course is modifying the energy that is reflected or emitted by the ground. All right, most of the remote sensing satellite platforms today are in near polar orbits, which means that the satellite travels northwards on the one side of the Earth and then towards the southern pole of the second half in its orbit. These are called ascending and descending passes, respectively. If the orbit is also sun-synchronous, the ascending pass is most likely on the shadowed side of the Earth, while the descending pass is on the sunlight side. So, sensor record the reflected solar energy, so passive sensor only image the surface on a descending pass when solar illumination is available and not in the ascending pass, because they are imaging the hemisphere of the Earth that is actually during nightline condition. Okay, nighttime condition. So there's no energy that is coming from the sun. Active sensors, which provide their own illumination, or passive sensors that record emitted thermal radiation, can also image the surface on ascending. So, if we are measuring thermal infrared with passive sensor, or we are using radar that is emitting their own source of energy, of course, they can also acquire in ascending passes, so in the hemisphere of the Earth, where it's actually night. So, this is the condition of ascending and descending pass. As a satellite revolves around the Earth, the sensor sees a certain portion of the Earth's surface. The area imaged on the surface is referred to as the swath, as you can see in the figures. Imaging swaths for spacebound sensors generally vary between tens and hundreds of kilometers wide. As the satellite orbits the Earth from pole to pole, its east-west position wouldn't change if the Earth didn't rotate. However, as seen from the Earth, it seems that the satellite is shifting westward because the Earth is rotating, of course, from west to east beneath it. This apparent movement allows the satellite SWOT to cover a new area with each consecutive pass, and this is the ability of these sun-synchronous orbits to use in a very efficient way the rotation movement of the Earth. The satellite's orbit and the rotation of the Earth was together to allow complete coverage of the Earth's surface after it has completed one complete cycle of orbit. So you see that if we start with a randomly selected path, we can establish what is called a revisit period, and using steerables, this is used if the acquisition, the revisit period is established, that is, as I mentioned before, is established the temporal resolution. So for example, for Landsat is something like 16 days, because Landsat is always acquiring in a natural position, so the sensor is perpendicular to the surface. But in a very high resolution sensor that are using steerable sensor, that means that are sensor that could be inclined, a satellite-borne instrument can view the area of nadir, so inclined, before and after the orbit pass over a target, thus making the revisit time less than the orbit cycle time. So if I'm acquiring a particular area, for example over Turin, in a certain orbit, in the next orbit, after 1 hour and a half, I can incline the sensor, acquiring again over Torino, and so reducing the temporal frequency of the acquisition, so lowering the temporal resolution. So the possibility to incline the sensor allows, you see, the possibility to acquire over two adjacent orbits. For example, in this example here, in these figures, I acquire in the first position in a perpendicular way. After the second orbit, I can incline the sensor and acquire again the same area. So you see, in this way, just incline the sensor, I can improve the temporal resolution. And this is, in this figure here, the representation projected on the ground of the different tracks of a system of orbits. And you see that, of course, there's a more dense path around the pole, because at every single orbit, the satellites, an heliosynchronous orbit, the satellite is passing through the north and the south pole. I will explain that in more technical way and with having examples during the labs. But so that means that if I'm inclined the sensor, I can improve the temporal resolution, and I can improve the temporal resolution also having another thing. So mounting more than one satellite over this one single orbit. So for example, this is the case of the Copernicus European Space Agency constellation of satellites, where we have for every single kind of sensor, we have two satellites that are embarking on board the same sensor mounted on the same orbit. So I can also improve the temporal resolution having more satellites with the same sensor that is acquiring over the same orbits. So concluding the concept of resolution, so having general remarks, I try to present the different types of resolution. From the functional point of view, however, it can be said that there is a sort of direct competition between the direct types of resolution, for which, for example, at a high geometrical or spectral resolution corresponds a low temporal resolution, or a high radiometric resolution necessarily, they correspond to a lower geometric and spectral resolution. This fact is essentially due to a close relationship between the geometric resolution and the spectral resolution. So that if on the one hand it is true that the radiant flux detected by a sensor does not depend geometrically neither from the distance nor from the detected area, but on the angle characteristics of view and from the detector area, as we mentioned at the beginning of the lecture, it is important to remember that, on the other hand, the same radiant quantity also depends on the width of the spectral range considered and is equivalent to the underlined integrals, you remember. Therefore, the spectral dimensioning of a sensor must always take into account its geometric resolution on the ground, but also of the radiometric resolution in the sense that two narrow spectral bands would imply values of radiant flux too small to be detected within a suitable dynamic representation. Thus, there is a close relationship between the different resolution, in particular, in order to maintain a good radiometric performance in the system use, a compromise sought between the spectral and geometric resolution characteristics. So, the above mentioned relationship between geometric and spectral resolution can be understood, taking into consideration the amount of energy that the sensor can acquire. This energy can be analytically described as follows, and this is a very important thing. P is the energy that is going to a detector of a sensor, and is affected by these different quantities, where tau is the atmospheric transmission coefficient, LD lambda and L lambda is the radiation that is coming from the ground, capital A is the area of the main parabolic mirrors, alpha is the plane angle of optical resolution of the instruments, delta lambda is the spectral range of acquisition. So if we are considering the different characteristics here, I mean, and we know that the energy that is recorded by the sensor is related to the area on the detector that is in some way related to this A capital A, that is the area of the main parabolic mirror that is proportional. I don't explain you in depth these things, that is proportional to the area of the detectors. Then we have this tau, that is something that is already set because it's the atmospheric transmission coefficient that we cannot influence transmission coefficient of the tropospheric layers. And also we cannot affect L lambda, that is the radiance that is coming from the ground. So the only things that we can modify are two, considering the tau and lambda are some physical constraints of the acquisition, and alpha is the angle of the optical, and the A capital A is the correspondent detector areas. What we can change is alpha and delta lambda. Alpha here, you see, is the plane angle of optical resolution of the instrument. It's something, and this is the squared alpha, because is the correspondent, is an angle, is measured in angle, but you see when we measured the EFOV, we can measure the EFOV in terms of angle of linear quantity. Let's imagine to have a linear quantity, this is the geometrical resolution on the ground, because we expect that the cell is squared on the ground. While here, delta lambda is a range of wavelengths, so if delta lambda is very large, that means that we are acquiring in very few spectral bands. For example, if delta lambda is ranging between 0.4 to 0.7, we are acquiring all the radiance that is coming from the ground in the whole visible in only one single bands. While here, larger is this alpha, larger will be the dimension of the cells of the image. So larger is alpha, lower is the geometric resolution. lower is alpha, larger will be the geometric resolution. So if you are talking about 1 meter here, that is a very low alpha quantity, that means that is a very large geometric resolution. But while if you are talking 1 kilometer here, that is a very large alpha value, that means that is a very low geometric resolution. So stating that we can change only these two things here, if we are reducing delta lambda, so that means that we are using very small wavelength interval, that means that we are using many different spectral bands, so we are enlarging the spectral resolution, so we are acquiring the signal in many different spectral bands, that means that we need to enlarge to have the same quantity of pitch, of that is the energy that is striking over the detector of the sensor, we need to enlarge this alpha. So that means that if we are improving the spectral resolution, we are lowering the geometric resolution. On the contrary, if we are improving the geometric resolution, so passing from kilometers to 1 meter of geometric resolution, to have the same P, we need to decrease we need to enlarge this spectral range. So that means to decrease the spectral resolution. So if we are increasing the geometric resolution, so we are acquiring at 1 meter on the ground, we need to have the same P to decrease the number of bands in which we are acquiring the signal. So that means that there's a very straight correlation between geometric and spectral resolution. So this is what I try to explain. And so we consider this lecture finished, the lecture number 8, that is related to observation system. And after 2 hours, we are finishing the lecture. So take care to everybody, and of course, never give up.